Okay, I would like to welcome everybody to this panel discussion on innovations of material hosted by DSM Engineering Plastics. Before I start, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Krijn Dijkstra. I'm Director of Advanced Engineering within DSM Engineering Plastics. And fortunately, I did not come alone, but I brought a couple of very knowledgeable people, my colleagues who are sitting here next to me. I will first quickly introduce them. On the far end, and the prettiest one we have in the room is Sujan Wang, or Wang Tujan, as they say in China, who is responsible for R&T of our polyester elastomers under the trade name of Arnitel, and Xytron, which is our trade name for our PPS product line. Next to her is sitting Jeroen Crèvecoeur, responsible for high-temperature polyamides, specifically our Stanil product line, 9146, and Ecopax, our bio-based polyamide, nylon 410. And then the last one, but not the least, is my dear friend Hans Hoekstra, who is responsible for our PPA portfolio under trade names 40 and 40As. During this panel discussion, we will guide you through some of the recent innovations, give a couple of examples. But to start off, we would like to give you a high-level overview how this new class of materials, these new high-performance materials, have been introduced over the last, I would even say, 30 years, because this year we actually celebrated the launch of the first high-temperature polyamide, Stanil. So we're going to show you a couple of highlights. There's more information on the screen. I'm going to click through, because we have an intermediate slide. Here you see a timeline of a lot of different names. I'm going to highlight a couple of them, and we will show some specific examples during this panel discussion where we talk about specific benefits, but also some of the more recent innovations that we've developed in these fields. Now, if you see the first one, I'm going to stand up here, and it makes it easier. It starts with a couple of random material, but it really started the whole field of polyamides, high-temperature polyamides, was actually kicked off by the launch of our Stanil 9146 product line. That was in 1986. 9146 kind of kicked this whole thing off. Now, then you see the launch of INTLC, a high-temperature polyester elastomer. You see Stanil Diablo, it was really taking the thermo-oxidative resistance of our materials to the next level, basically taking continuous use temperatures from 175, 185 to 225. It was a major step up. And you see the different, there are different product lines in this Diablo technology launch. You see the launch of Ecopax, which was the first polyamide four-block-based, bio-based polyamide. Xytron was launched within DSM, then INTEL HD, again polyester elastomer with some high-end properties we will discuss later. And then based on the 4T portfolio, we also launched 40As during the case show in 2016. We will explain a couple of these examples during the this panel discussion, but we would really like to start with where the whole high-temperature nylon world started. It is the Stanil product line. So we would like to ask Jeroen to kind of give a little bit of the background why this material is so special and what are the, some new recent innovations that we've launched and actually in the process of launching during this year and early next year. So Jeroen, can you take the floor from here? We might have a couple of questions during your presentation, so you might be interrupted, but let's see how it goes.
Sure. Thank you, Krijn. Krijn introduced a couple of innovations in the previous slides. A couple of those innovations have one thing in common, and that is the special proprietary DSM building block diaminobutane, also referred to by us as C4, and it gives very special properties to the polymers containing that C4 building block. First of all, Stanil, that indeed was launched 30 years ago already, but after that also Ecopax and 4T, that Hans will talk about later on, contain this special building block, and it gives rise to very special performance. Okay, to start off with Stanil, what does now make Stanil so special? In fact, it all relates to the chemical structure of the chains. Basically, the C4 block results in a very symmetrical chain structure, having 4C atoms in between the functional groups, the functional acid groups or the functional amine groups, making it highly symmetrical, and in that sense crystallization behavior is very fast and also results in very high crystallinity. It also results in the ability to crystallize in a parallel manner, but also in an anti-parallel manner. So if you compare that to polyamide 6,6, where one building block has 4C atoms in between the functional groups, but the other has 6C atoms between the functional groups, this symmetry is missing, resulting in lower melting point, lower crystallinity, and also lower crystallization rate. Those are the characteristics of steniel that make it special. Despite that fact, despite the high crystallinity, it has a high moisture absorption, which is related to the fast crystallization behavior of steniel, resulting in a relatively open amorphous phase, resulting in a lot of free volume, which results in high moisture uptake.
Is this something, Jeroen, sorry to interrupt you, is that something that you could affect? Or is this really kind of built in and there is nothing you can do about it?
Well, it's a good question, Krijn. In principle, this is what you have after injection molding. But if you give the material, the parts for that matter, a heat treatment, then the amorphous phase has the time and ability to compact, to reduce the free volume, and you see that the moisture uptake goes down dramatically, even to levels below that of 6,6.
Okay, and what does it mean, thermal treatment? Sounds a little bit fake to me.
Thermal treatment means what we also refer to as annealing, putting it for a couple of hours in an oven at, say, 230 degrees, so below the melting point in the solid state, give the material the ability to compact that amorphous phase and to relax.
Okay.
What I would like to focus on now is a material that we recently developed and recently launched in the market, which we called AGR3. It's a material with very special wear and friction characteristics. As I will show, it has a substantially lower coefficient of friction than the typical materials that are in the market, PA66 plus PTFE. It has also a lower wear rate or a similar wear rate, and it has significantly better processing behavior, and last but not least, it's free of PTFE, so it's also more sustainable and environmentally friendly material.
Okay.
This is the targeted application area. So in timing chain drive systems, typically chain tensioners are being used, and guides are used to guide the chain, but to also make sure that there is sufficient tension on the chain. As you can imagine, these parts are subjected to high loads and high wear rates. So wear and friction is very important here. Energy losses in those timing chain systems are nearly for 50% caused by these chain guides and chain tensioners. So you can imagine that reducing friction coefficients is very important in this application. We have in the development used two test methods to evaluate that friction coefficient. One is a small lab scale based test setup that we have in-house. It's the ball on pyramid test, where basically a ball is rotating on plastic test specimens immersed in oil, and then the force is measured, and we can do that at different temperatures. But we also made use of chain on guide tests, which is more closely to the actual application, where strips of material are pushed against a chain that is rotating at high speed at a certain normal force, and then torques are measured to record the friction. This is a typical friction coefficient of friction graph as a function of sliding speed that you see for these kind of lubricated friction states. It's called the Strebeck curve, where you have, depending on the speed of the chain, you have different thicknesses in oil layer, and based on the thickness of that oil layer, you have different regimes where different material properties can dominate. And most important in this graph is actually that these two tests that I just explained, this ball and pyramid test and the chain on guide test, have different specific speeds and are operating in different regimes, which is the reason that the curves that I will represent in the next slide look a little bit differently. So it's respectively the red part and the green part in this curve. If you look here, you see the coefficient of friction as a function of the speed, the sliding speed at which it was tested for different materials. Staniel AGR2 is the current material that we have in the market already for a long time. It's staniel based on PTFE as a lubricant. And then you see two versions of AGR3, the green and the yellow one, and the red curve is a competitor material, polyamide 6,6 plus PTFE. And you can clearly see here, actually, in both graphs, the ball and pyramid graph and the chain on guide graph, that both AGR3 materials result in a substantially lower coefficient of friction at different speeds, most prominent at low speeds, but also at higher speeds. You see this advantage, which can cause a substantial reduction of the losses in the timing chain system. Talking about wear, we measured the track depths during such chain on guide tests. So the chain will basically result in tracks being formed in those strips that we tested. And if you looked at the depth, then that is a measure for the wear that has taken place. And there, actually, one of the AGR3 materials has even a lower wear rate, whereas the other is comparable to the PTFE containing materials, the traditional materials. One other advantage of AGR3 is the ease of processing. So, as you can see here, typical PTFE containing polyamides have poor surfaces. There is a risk that streaks appear on the surface, and that is not happening with our new solution, AGR3.
If I may ask you, Roen, these pretty bad surface qualities of these PTFE containing materials, do we understand how they are formed, basically, mechanistically?
Yeah, basically, we have seen that PTFE can, because of the end group modification that they have, can result in volatiles that come to the surface and form very small bubbles. And these bubbles, on macroscopic parts, are shown as streaks. So it's really has to do with the PTFE in the material.
Sorry,
absence of that chemistry really guarantees you much better surface quality.
Yeah, the HER3 technology has different chemistry where no volatiles are being formed, and indeed much better surfaces are being formed.
Yeah. If I may continue asking the question, follow the surface, it might look bad, but does it actually influence your wear and friction properties that you need for your application?
Well,
is it correlated?
In fact, it does, although you would not immediately expect it. Besides only the coefficient of friction, there is a so-called pitting wear happening to these kind of chain tensioners because of slapping of the chain to the surface, because of fatigue behavior of the plastic. Pitting wear can happen, and we have seen that these kind of surface defects accelerate that pitting wear. So having a smooth surface is not just for the looks, but is also important for the performance of the parts in practice.
Okay. Maybe a little bit of maybe partly related, but maybe also a little bit different. Huh? You've shown here really good wear and friction performance of a specific Stanil grade. Is this kind of a general benefit of Stanil, or is this kind of focused only on this specific grade? And where is this benefit of wear and friction, is it usable in other areas of Stanil?
It's basically good wear and friction properties is not just related to the timing chain systems. It's also valuable in, for example, gears, an application where Stanil is widely applied. And it's really a material characteristic of Stanil, which comes back to what I explained earlier, to the very high crystallinity of Stanil. That makes it very resistant to wear, but it's also favorable for friction.
Okay.
High modulus materials typically have lower friction coefficients.
Okay, so the ACR3 basically enhances an intrinsic benefit in the material that for this specific application.
Indeed, yeah. Indeed. Okay. So that was already the case with AGR2 addition of PTFE, like that is working for 6.6, but AGR3 further enhances that strength of Stanil.
Nice.
So, yeah, summarizing, we have seen that both the candidates for AGR3 resulted in a significant reduction of coefficient of friction compared to PTFE-containing material. The AGR3B material gave the best friction, and the A material gave the best balance in wear and friction. So depending on the application and the normal forces, the best choice can be made between those materials. The wear performance is comparable or better to traditional materials in this application. And an important advantage is that the processing window is wider, and surface quality is much better. Materials will be free of streaks. And finally, the solution is PTFE free, which makes it also a more sustainable solution than the traditional PTFE-containing materials.
Okay.
So with that, I would like to finalize this, the Stanil part.
Yeah, thanks, Jeroen. So this was the first start of the high-temperature polyamide. Now, the world has not been standing still. There have been many developments focusing on further enhancing material solutions in high-temperature polyamides. The most noticeable one are the PPAs, the semi-aromatic polyamides. So I just would like to ask Hans, what have you done to take this specific Stanil benefits, have you translated that into the PPA field? So can you tell a little bit what we did in the 4T and the 40A's environment?
Absolutely, okay. And that takes us back basically to the slide that Jeroen already showed, right? This C4 chemistry is rather special chemistry. So the C4 diamine is the basic building block that we also use in our PPA portfolio. And the reason for doing that is actually nicely explained on the next slide. What you see here in this graph is the melting point and the glass transition temperature of a series of polyamides, which are also called XT polyamides. So these are, let's say, the simplest PPA molecules that you can make. They are homopolymers. And if you look at that slide, and then you look at some of the commercially available diamines for, with which you can make a PPA, then you already clearly see that if you make polyamide 40, you get the highest glass transition temperature and the highest melting point, and more importantly is that higher glass transition temperature. And if you look at the curves, they're rather correlated. And why do you get that basically with 40-based PPAs? Is because the glass transition temperature and the melting point are mainly governed by the Emmet density, which is the shorter you make your diamine, the C14, the higher the content of aromatic rings, as explained in the upper right corner of the slide. That's the aromatic part which gives the material actually the high stiffness and the high TG. And the higher the density of those aromatic units, the higher the glass transition temperature you have, the higher the melting point you have. Now, looking at that high melting point, because if you look at the blue dot on the 4T and then look at the left-hand axis, that you see that 4T, pure 4T would be a PPA that would be melting at around 430 degrees C, which means this is a material which is actually almost melt intractable. It's not a material that you can use as is. So what we actually do is that with that technology, we make it usable for injection molding applications, and we do that by smartly playing on making copolymers of these 4T. 4T is an important block, but our 4T polymers, both 4T and 4TAs, are actually copolymers based on that 4T technology. But the 4 technology, as the graph nicely explains, enables you to get very high TGs, and they go up to 160 degrees C in the case of 4TAs in this case.
Hans, if I look at your graph, then I see that also polyamide 6T has a rather high melting point in that graph, actually much higher, it seems, than commercial 6T materials available in the market.
It's a good point, Jeroen. That's actually the 6T, and it's a class that's often referred to in industry as these are 6T PPAs. Fair enough, they are 60 PPAs, but like we do with the 4T technology, they start with the 6T technology, so starting from a lower TG, and also have to make copolymers, because a pure 60 would have a melting point of around 370, 380 degrees C, again being almost melt intractable and not really suited for common injection molding applications. So what if you look at the let's say the competitive PPA landscape, what most of the big and well-known PPAs are actually variants of copolymers of 6T. The best well-knowns are the 6T66-like chemistries, like for instance you have with Solvay Amodal series, or the 6T, you sometimes call it DT, or 6T MP MDT if you take the real chemical name, which is a slightly higher TG PPA that's also well known in the industry, which is marketed as Zytel by DuPont.
Are these what they call high TG PPAs?
Well, the 60, that's a classification that a little bit depends on the exact polymer chemistry. So you have 6T66 materials that are relatively high TG. When the content of 6.6 is really high, then you have relatively low, because then you have a 6.6 plus. So the high TG material or the high TG PPAs, usually you take a cutoff in a TG, and you can actually use different chemistries to do that.
Okay.
Let's say the cutoff is around 120, 130 degrees C, a little bit arbitrary how you choose that.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the high TG ones. What they all have in common is that the aromatic content of the high TG PPAs is higher than the aromatic content of the lower TGs.
Okay.
If you have substantial amount of 6.6, it will be lower. Now, if you then would look at these typical chemistries that you see a lot, so the 6.6, the 6T based PPA chemistries, and here I have a plot basically comparing up to about 150 degrees C, what is the stiffness of my PPA in function of high temperature, because why would you use a PPA versus an aliphatic polyamide, for instance, is, well, with a PPA, you get a bit broader temperature window in which you have maximum mechanical performance, right? As soon as a material goes to its TG, you get significant loss of stiffness. And with these PPAs, you have a bigger temperature window where you can benefit of the high stiffness of these materials. Now, if you then look at...
Sorry to interrupt you, but do you also see that in strength, or is this predominantly a benefit in stiffness?
The benefit in stiffness is larger than the benefit in strength.
Okay.
Because strength and stiffness, there's also an elongation argument, right? And generally, the aliphatic polymers have a bit better elongation. So strength-wise, the difference is less than the difference on stiffness. But also there, well, in all honesty, a TG, you don't really see in strength. What you see actually in strength, that's a continuous decrease of strength over temperature. Mm-hmm. And that TG is not really noticeable. But many applications are actually designed on strength and not so much, on stiffness, not so much on strength, because you typically, for a structural metal replacement part, you never want it to break. You actually want to only use the high stiffness for these types of materials.
Okay.
But then looking at these materials, if you look at the, let's say, the typical 6T66 type of chemistry, that's the light blue curve. Now you already see that our traditional 4T that we had is actually something that mimics that kind of performance quite well. And even a hint, I'll show it in the next slide, towards the higher temperature side, that we then actually become better. If you go to the higher aromatic content polyamides, like the dark blue curve here, which is the 60, let's call it 60DT to have the short abbreviation, that's a higher TG material. And there you see, if you would compare to our regular 4T or a 6066, that quite broadens your temperature window to go to maximum stiffness at higher temperatures. What we managed to do, and that's our latest innovation in ACE, which is a modification, let's say, of the original 4T polymer, compared to these high TG PPAs that were already in the market, we've actually managed to make that same stretch again from our high TG to the conventional high TG materials that the conventional high TG materials made to the more conventional PPAs. And that basically, if you look at, let's say, up to 150 degrees C, we're able with these 40A's materials to have a stiffness retention compared to room temperature stiffness of about 75%, which really broadens your window for metal replacement types of applications, as some examples are shown on the slide.
Right. And you were able to keep the melting point in a manageable area, or did it also shift up with...
The melting point compared to 4T is slightly shift, but by, let's say, smart combination of the copolymer that we choose, because that is what we aim for in 40As. Let's say standard injection molding equipment can go up to about 350 degrees C. So yes, we increased the melting point compared to 4T, but we stayed below that limit. So this is still a material that can be processed on conventional injection molding equipment. You don't need highly specialized machinery to be able to work with this material.
Yeah. Okay.
Hans, it looks all great on at room temperature or at dry condition, but it's famous to everybody that polyamide absorb water. So what is the influence of moisture on the stiffness?
That's an absolute fair question, even stronger, because as what Jeroen already indicated, that the 4 technology actually brings high polarity, but that gives you nice high temperature properties, but also higher moisture uptake. Fair enough, this takes much less moisture than Staniel would do, but it's still a PPA that takes quite some moisture, basically. I'm going to skip this slide and go to the moisture slide, basically. What you see, if you compare our 4T to conventional PPAs, that even although 4T, thanks to the 4 technology, it takes a bit more water. What you actually have to look at is basically the stiffness at typical conditions. And the condition plotted here, so these are the stiffness plots as a function of temperature at a very regular automotive conditioning, which is a typically the maximum amount of moisture that you will have in automotive parts. And there you see, especially for 40As, which is the dark curve here, basically, the dark pink or purple curve. You see, now let's say if you look at metal replacement opportunities in automotive, the maximum temperature under humid conditions that you would typically have is somewhere between 100 and 110 degrees C. If you have applications that run for longer times at much higher temperatures, anyway, the material will dry. But around that 100 degrees C, you can have these high humidities higher moisture contents in the material. And then if you look at it, sure, you get a shift of TG, so suddenly at 150 degrees C, you have much lower stiffness than you had in dry conditions. Mm. But the more relevant temperature range, say, let's say up to that 110 degrees C, let's say 4T is on par with both the higher and lower TG PPAs in the market and yeah. stiffness in that area. But if you look at 4TAs, there you see a serious increase still because of the starting very high TG. Yeah. You do drop, but you have a serious increase in stiffness at those temperatures.
But you also could say that even at much higher temperatures, you keep a benefit.
Yeah, exactly. We actually skipped to that slide, but let's maybe go to the previous slide, because that's a good point to make anyway. The Stanil argument of that C4 and the high symmetry giving you high crystallinity, that two-part, although crystallinity for a PPA is lower than Stanil for sure, mm-hmm. but two-part you get that same benefit in the 4T types of chemistries. And that's really noticeable at high temperature. And the temperature I indicated in this graph is actually 260 degrees C, which is in the electronics market a very important temperature, because that's the temperature at which SMT connectors are reflowed. So a connector needs to be able to withstand that temperature and have, actually for good performance, also good mechanical performance at those temperatures. Now, if you then compare that to the other PPAs that are in the market, you see even for 4T, but for sure for 4TAs, you have quite a step up at stiffness at that high temperature site because of the higher crystallinity. And that, for instance, enables you, and we have a few grades based on that technology in the market that enable you to meet JEDEC-1 blister performance, yeah. which is a well-known and important and the highest blister resistance class you have for SMT electronics. And that you can get thanks to that high crystallinity. So although you take a bit more moisture than conventional PPAs would do, your mechanics are so much better at these high temperatures that you actually get to the best reflow class in these connectors.
I think that's also interesting for automotive, where SMT is going to be Absolutely. Increasing more and more with electrification and the computerization Absolutely. Of our vehicles.
Yeah. There, apart from let's say metal replacement opportunities yeah. there that we brought, and we're very well positioned yeah. with that great portfolio thanks to all the electronics efforts mm-hmm. we've done in the past to also play a role there. Absolutely.
Yeah. And your one is also Stanil. Is that something that you could use in that automotive electronics area from a performance point of view, or would the 4T really be the material of choice?
Yeah, that depends a little bit on the exact requirements. But for certain applications, it can for sure be used. But Stanil, because of the high moisture uptake, has some sensitivity to blistering, depending on the thickness of the application. In such cases, 4T would be a better choice.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, that's what basic. So basically, rounding off, what is special about 4-based PPAs? It's you stretch the window of maximum mechanical performance to a high level, up to 150, 160 degrees C, I would say. And finally, also for the very high temperature side, and some applications need that, thanks to the increased crystallinity over conventional PPAs, you also have a mechanical benefit there. And with that, I would leave it.
Yeah, maybe just a final question. Have you talked about a little bit about electronics and connectors, structural parts, what you see in the automotive, especially now with the new energy vehicles? Is cooling starts to be more important? Can you tell, you don't have a slide on it, but can you tell something about chemical resistance, for instance, of this type of materials in these more challenging settings that you see in the in cooling
absolutely.
Systems?
That gets more and more important, of course, the water glycol resistance, etc. If you especially look at 4DAs, we've made formulations that we've introduced into the market for exactly these kind of applications, because these chemistries with the higher aromatic content, basically, they are the chemistries that are typically much more stable against hydrolysis or acid-catalyzed hydrolysis, and many of these, let's say, fluid resistances in the end turn out to be acid-catalyzed hydrolysis. And 4TAs, for sure, is a material, thanks to its very high aromatic content, that is, for a polyamide, quite resistant to these to these kind of fluids.
Interesting. Well, thanks, Hans, for your explanation on the PPA, our PPA portfolio. Now, you're a little bit younger than maybe us, so you might not have seen Monty Python, but I would like to make the bridge here that let's go for something completely different. Because you have been talking about materials with high strength, high stiffness, High strength is always nice, but high stiffness is not always something that you want. Sometimes you want the high flexibility. And that's going a little bit to the different side, completely different side of the spectrum. So I would like to ask to Jan, can you talk a little bit more? Can we also do high temperature materials that are very flexible?
Definitely,
of course, otherwise I would not ask. But do you have one other point?
Yeah. Thanks, Cry. So in the last few minutes, I will explain a little bit of actually a very nice innovation. It was not really recent developed, but a couple of years ago, we developed a new family, introduced a new family into our Arnitel world. As you all know, Arnitel is a semi-crystalline block copolymer. And we have a broad and quite wide portfolio where in this kind of TPE world, you can have many, many choices as the chemistry is very versatile. You have the hard block and you have the soft block. Mm-hmm. By change of the type of the soft block or the type of hard block, you can make a lot of chemistry out of it. And today, it's a really a nice innovation where we have some connection with our high temperature polyamide friends. It's also used in high temperature applications. Here is the application. Maybe just to link with polyamide, actually DSM Engineering Plastic already serves a very nice portfolio, including polyamide, into the air management system today. So we have a very famous grade, Stanio Diablo. We also have Aquilon Diablo grades, which are very active in our hot charge air duct application, where you can see on the screen. Very demanding application. And in Arnitel world, we have been selling very successfully in our Arnitel P grades in the cold side, which is the blue part of the curve. Mm-hmm. Those are the cold charge air ducts. And last few years, we have been thinking, can we also enter into the hot zone with our Arnitel solution where flexibility sometimes is needed? This is the innovation that I want to explain. If you think about traditionally how do you make a hard charge air ducts, typically you have two sides rubber, very high temperature rubber, and then in between is the high temperature plastics. You can use nylon, for instance, and you connect them with metal, or you welded them together, as you can see on the graph, the top part. And this is a combi component which you have to connect it together. With our innovation, it's really make your life a lot easier because we go through a 3D suction blow molding process where you can make your part in one step. You make your part, and then you can imagine you really make the part design a lot simpler for our engineers. They don't have to think how to connect them. And of course, safety-wise, you don't have any potential issue or risk of leakage because nothing is connected, it's one piece.
Yeah, I've heard one time that this was the biggest, a really big cost factor because it's a manual thing. What I understood had the way they do this clamping. And whatever you do, this is still there are failures in this. And this
Absolutely.
Is one of the top recall items or things they need to fix later on with this multi-material solutions.
Yeah, definitely, indeed. Yeah. I mean, if you have a one-part solution, definitely will increase your safety factor, right? Yeah. So the last point of advantage, as you see on the slide, certainly without all the insertion and metal, you save weight. And of course, the system assembly cost has been going down thanks to the introduction of one part. So this part is Arnitel HT, is a family which is blow moldable, it's a blow moldable grade. Here's a plot which I want to emphasize a little bit of our superior heat aging performances. The red and green plot are our successful commercial grade from the Arnitel P family, which is a different soft block, just for information. And there, as you can see, we are already standing out compared to our competition TPE in the market. In the plot, what you see in the X-axis is the temperature that you expose your material to. And the y-axis is a very common practice of using the half-lifetime retention of your elongation net break because we are talking about very flexible material. As you can see, the scale of differences is huge. And the reason behind it is also thanks to our very broad portfolio and toolbox that we have in our chemistry, we choose aliphatic polycarbonate as our soft block, which intrinsically is much more stable towards thermo-oxidative attack compared to the other competitor chemistry which they use. So there you see we are gradually certainly moving towards our high temperature play my territory, offering another solution to our designer and engineers.
What type of flexibility are we talking about here? Is this very rubbery or is this kind of in between?
In between. Yeah. And of course, you see and in HT portfolio, we have two grades.
Yeah.
So, and we also there offer softer and harder hardness towards the engineers so they can choose as well. So HT is a family of several hardness as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
Does the hardness still affect the heat aging retention properties or are they similar?
They're very similar. Yeah. I'll come back to that a little bit later on. I also want to emphasize that the fact that our HT family has really superior chemical resistance. This is a quite busy plot, but in the automotive industry, it's a very famous, a norm from Volkswagen. It's called blow-by test. Basically, it's to check how resistant you are towards chemical. This is a very interesting test. It's in cycles of 24 hours. So in 24 hours, what you do with your material, you make some bars.
Mm-hmm.
You submerge into, first of all, very strong acid for 4 hours. You take it out. You put it in again for 18 hours in engine oil, take it out, and you put it again in a few hours in fuel. So within 24 hours, you experience quite a lot of liquid to a little bit try to mimic the reality.
Mm-hmm.
And typical norm that you needed for TPE material is after 3 cycle, you retain the property 50%. As you can see probably very vividly in the graph, we are still pretty strong after 9 cycles. And just for your reference, typical our competitors in the market doesn't even pass 3 cycles.
Okay.
It does indeed. Sounds like a pretty severe test. I'm wondering, how is now the performance of your Arnitel HT compared to the requirements in the real application? And how does it compare to competitor materials?
Yeah, like I mentioned, the cycles which they are looking at from our OEM standpoint is 3 cycles. And they would like to have 50% retention after 3 cycles, remain in terms of elongation break and strength. And our competitors, some pass borderline, and of course some didn't pass. And HT obviously offer much more security because it's very robust over 3 cycles. Even after 9 cycles, we are even maintaining the mechanical properties. So that's really a value proposition of choosing Arnitel HT in this case for the hot charge air ducts.
If you look at, you commented already why it was better in heat aging, but do we have a grasp why that also in this, let's say, chemical attacks, it's actually more stable than competitive TPE materials?
Yeah, very, very, very good question, Hans. Actually, we give a lot of thought when we develop this material. As we know, in our competitor landscape, typically the TPE solution in the market, they make their polymer in one-step polymerization, which means they are able to reach medium viscosity, but that medium viscosity is not enough to do blow molding. So what our peers do is to add rheology modifier to change the rheology behavior so you can make part via blow molding process. However, as we can imagine, those additives are not polymer. So what it does is change behavior, but it doesn't increase your molecular weight. So this additive also have a potential drawback, which is the fact that they will probably absorb solvent and liquid which you encounter during the actual use. Our way of making is in DSM, thanks to our history of Arnitel C, we use a very unique way of processing it, and we are able to really make linear, really long chain polymer out of it. And you can imagine if you have a very long linear chain, it just takes longer and takes more chain breakage until it reaches the low molecular weight where your material property fail. So our understanding behind our chemical resistance is really the fact that we have longer chain, linear chain, uniform polymer, not so much additive into it, so we really maintain the structure and takes longer until it breaks down.
It reminds me a bit of the story of Jeroen, with the PTFE, that yes, you can use additives to improve a certain property, but everything you add has can have negative consequences also. So the more you design it really in your polymer, and this seems like almost like nanoscience molecular engineering, and what this reminds me of, and the less you need to add to it, the less you also disturb other negative potential properties that these additives can have. So that there's even there a little bit of comparison between the two stories. I like
that. The more intrinsic the strength really of your polymer is.
You design it really in the polymer itself.
Yeah. Exactly. That's the beauty of this innovation.
Yeah. Yeah.
And to round it up, I think it's, I hope I showed you a very nice innovation from Arnitel family, Arnitel HT product offering a many grades inside. It really gives you a system cost reduction, right? Because you provide a single part solution. It will help you to achieve less weight, which in the end will help you to cut down the CO2 generation. It also has less potential of leakage because it's a single part. There is no connection needed. Also, among all the TPC families, TPE families, we are really the one has the highest chemical and heat aging performances among all the TPE solutions. And of course, extremely good, like I mentioned, the chemical resistance compared to the other offering in the market.
Okay, thanks everybody for interesting presentations. We went through a number of things. We had a couple of questions in between, but maybe there are some remaining questions that you want to ask that we did not get through or that we talked about later on. One of you guys has some
Jujuan, this was a very interesting innovation on Arnitel HT. Is there any other interesting innovations ongoing in Arnitel product line?
Absolutely, absolutely. As you know, Arnitel is really a broad portfolio. We have very soft and very hard and different type of families, right? Different soft lock, as I mentioned. So unfortunately, we don't have time to cover it up in this session, but my colleagues, Andre, who will give another talk regarding the innovation areas we're working on Arnitel. Disclose a little bit. We are actually working on breathable membrane, foaming, so many more to come in Arnitel indeed. Thanks.
Good.
So what's the specific thing on foaming that you can maybe give a little bit of a teaser for the Andre presentation?
Sure. We are actively working on the foaming areas where you can imagine with a focus on, for example, sportswear and apparels. So you will see more examples there where we are already actively in and commercialized in those areas via Andre's talk.
Maybe just an also more general question from my side. We talked a little bit about cooling, and there's a lot of things going on in thermal, let's not call it cooling, it's called thermal management. Mm-hmm. If you go to battery electric vehicles, hydrogen vehicles, you see much more demands on cooling. Not only cooling, it's heating, it's much more active. There's battery cooling, power control units, e-motor, whatever. Do we have other stuff next to the PPA that we talked about that are relevant? Does anyone one of you have activities related to to cooling systems?
Yeah, like you when you were introducing, right? So one of the product line which I'm also taking care of technology side is Citron, which is our PPS family. As it is well known, PPS is also one of the candidates to be used in thermal management system. And as a matter of fact, we have worked out a very nice innovation, a new product introduced to the targeting thermal management application. It's our Super HR, so 4080 HR Citron grade, where it shows really superior performance in water glycol resistance. And also, it's a very nice complement in our PPS portfolio offering. So indeed.
Okay. Any other questions from the panel?
Not from my side.
Not from your side, Jeroen. Anything other burning of Tujan?
No, maybe interesting to mention that within the C4 family, we also have EcoPax. You mentioned that, which is polyamide 410. It's for to 70% bio-based material. With also lower moisture uptake, relatively good chemical resistance, at least for aliphatic polyamides. Also an interesting and high-performance product within that C4 family.
Mm.
Okay, and you triggered me a little bit with your HR, because one of the things also what you see now again becoming very active is hydrogen, so fuel cell technology. And there also with, I saw some recent results on really good performance of Xytron in this hydrogen leaching type of experiment. So I still like the hydrogen side. There's a lot of debate, of course, with the battery electric, hydrogen combinations, compressed natural gas. But the hydrogen is interesting. And of course, next to we did not talk about our Echelon portfolio, and we cannot talk about everything, but we have some really nice things happening with fuel lock in hydrogen tanks, liners. I also personally have a connection with fuel cell, because I like the technology that you have water and then you have, or hydrogen, then you have water as combustion products. So it's interesting. So also there are some nice things happening, but as said, we cannot talk about everything.
I think one thing to add there, because obviously I know what you're referring to. I think when we at DSM, when we work on innovation, a lot of times we benefit a lot bigger than what it original planned for. Mm-hmm. Take Cytron HR grade as example. It was developed targeting thermal management system, but thanks for our understanding of interface and also the whole PPS chemistry, we are managing to actually benefit from the understanding. And we see some very interesting results, for example, on very little leakage, right? Yeah. For the fuel cell application. Yeah. So we really benefit, and you get some surprises.
And the same with fuel lock, because it originally was developed for small petrol tanks and lawnmowers and chainsaws and that outdoor power equipment. And we took that from there with some additional development work to CNG tanks, and from there to hydrogen tanks, because also there the high barrier properties that you have against fuels, it translates into these different molecules, whether it's CNG or even hydrogen. And you can actually measure that you have better hydrogen barrier properties in this Echelon fuel lock versus very typical other polyamide solutions out there. So some of these benefits and the understanding of these benefits, it really helps that you can model it, you can predict it from a basic fundamental scientific physical understanding how these materials behave, absorption, diffusion, and that translates into this type of new, kind of exciting new developments.
Exactly.
So it's kind of funny.
Anything
else you guys want to add?
Yeah, there is much more to talk about, but I think we should leave it at this.
We should leave it at this, then I will close the meeting. Again, I would like to thank our speakers here today, to Jan, Jeroen and Hans. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope there's something interesting. Don't hesitate to reach out to us. If you have questions, if you want to explore certain fields better or in more detail, we are always happy to talk to you. And with that, I wish you a nice day. I hope you enjoyed the other presentations we have. And thanks for the attention.